Hi there. Welcome, everybody, to today's event, Tackling Climate Change in Fragile States and Protracted Crisis Situation. Today's event is part of the IIED Debates series. We've got a really fantastic panel lined up, so we're delighted to have so many of you joining our virtual space today. So with that, I'm really happy to hand over to Simon Addison, who is our moderator for today's session. Simon, over to you, please.
Thanks so much, Juliet, and good afternoon, good morning or good evening to everybody who's joining us around the world, depending on which time zone you happen to be in. And welcome to this IIED debate in which we'll be examining how the climate emergency can be tackled effectively in fragile states and protracted crises situations, and what role humanitarian actors, both national and international, can play in addressing climate risks and climate impacts in contexts where conflict and fragile governance present compounding risks for affected populations. As Juliet said, my name is Simon Addison. I will be your moderator for today's debate. I'm a principal researcher in IIED's climate change group, where I work on issues relating to climate change governance and finance. We're coming to this debate in the knowledge that fragile and conflict-affected states are among the countries that are most vulnerable to climate impacts. So from the Sahel to the Horn of Africa, from the Middle East to Asia and Latin America, rural and urban communities are already affected by the impacts of violent conflict and weak governance, but are also suffering from the increasingly frequent and intense impacts of climate change. And these put lives at risk, they destroy livelihoods, cause famines, and drive displacement. And these climate impacts also undermine the ability of households, communities, and states to cope with those risks, adapt to climate change, or to achieve their long-term development aspirations, and place further pressure on weak institutions that make it even more difficult to overcome the root causes of the conflict and instability that affect them. In many of these contexts, humanitarian actors, both national and international, have a critical role to play in saving lives, protecting livelihoods, building resilience, and fostering sustainable development. But climate change itself poses a serious challenge to the way that they work. As climate risks grow with each increment of global heating, the need for humanitarian relief and resilience support increases. But humanitarian finance and humanitarian reach are not able to keep pace. Tackling climate change also requires humanitarians to deal not only with the immediate impacts of conflict, displacement, and disasters for vulnerable people, but to also help put in place the resources, the capabilities, and institutions they need to address climate risks over the medium to long term. So in this debate, we will discuss these and related issues by having a conversation with a panel of distinguished humanitarian and development practitioners, academics, and policy experts who bring a wealth of experience and expertise and different perspectives to this important question. Joining us from Nairobi in Kenya is Degan Ali. Degan is an internationally renowned humanitarian leader and organisational development consultant and the executive director of Adeso, or African Development Solutions. Adeso is a path-breaking African humanitarian and development NGO that operates in Somalia and northern Kenya, and which is committed to changing the way that people think about and deliver aid in Africa, catalyzing innovative, locally led solutions that generate long-lasting change at the grassroots level, and by challenging the business-as-usual way that aid is delivered. From Brussels, we're joined by Abdurahman Sharif, who is Senior Director of Partnerships and Outreach at Internews Europe. And he is a former director of the Somalia NGO Consortium and was a special advisor to development and international relations to the Prime Minister of Somalia, where he provided high-level advisory support as a specialist on development and international relations. From Brighton, we're joined by Professor Kleena Raleigh, who is a senior professor of political violence and geography at the University of Sussex. She's also the founder and executive director of the Armed Conflict Location and Event Data Project, or ACLED, which she founded in 2014 and which works with nearly 200 local researchers to track conflict events in 50 countries across the globe. From Oxford, we're joined by Paul Knox-Clark, Paul is a co-founder and principal of Prepare, which is a new initiative to improve the way humanitarian actors respond to the global climate emergency. A former head of research, evaluation and communications at ALNAP, Paul has led a number of initiatives to catalyze innovation and reform in the humanitarian sector and has over 20 years experience, including roles in as a practitioner within the UN and international NGOs. Then from Geneva, we're joined by Dr. Catherine Luna Grayson, who is a policy advisor with the International Committee for the Red Cross and Red Crescent, where she leads research and policy work on how the Red Cross movement can adapt to respond to the climate crisis. And last year, she was the lead author on their flagship report on climate change in conflict-affected situations, When the Rain Turns to Dust. And finally, from London, we are joined by Caroline Voot, who is a health policy, climate and environment advisor for Médecins Sans Frontières, or Doctors Without Borders. And she has a background in social justice and public health and has worked on humanitarian crises around the world since 2008. And currently she is leading work on climate and environmental issues for MSF and is currently coordinator of the MSF Global Health Actors Network. So we're really thrilled and honoured to have such a distinguished panel for this discussion. And so without further ado, we'll move on into the discussion part of the debate. So to kick things off, we're going to focus in on one situation, a specific context where climate change has intersected with long-standing challenges of violent conflict and state fragility. We're going to be looking particularly at issues relating to Somalia. Now, over the past 30 years, communities in Somalia have been living with a triple crisis of violent political conflict and state fragility, large-scale population displacements and chronic humanitarian emergencies, and climate change that is driving increasingly frequent and ever more severe droughts, floods, and environmental degradation. In 2011, this combination of threats precipitated one of the most serious famines of recent decades. And right now, millions of people face severe food insecurity across Somalia due to the compounding impacts of drought and floods, desert locusts, violent conflict, and the COVID-19 pandemic. So Degan Ali, you've worked at the front line of the humanitarian crisis in Somalia for many years. How do you see climate change impacting communities who are also affected by ongoing conflict and state fragility in Somalia?
Yeah, thank you, Simon. You know, as you were talking, I was thinking about Adeso's journey and the work that we have been doing from its inception when it was founded in 1991 and moved to Somalia in 1994 by Fatima Jibril, who is probably the most well-known environmental activist in Somalia. She's won many awards for her work, and she's also my mother and the founder of Adeso. And she was talking about conservation issues, climate change, deforestation, before it was sexy, before anybody knew about it, because she understood very clearly and saw with her own eyes the transformation that had happened in the communities. These are pastoralist communities. And pastoralism is the most efficient way to use dry lands. It's the most effective way to use dry lands. But at the time of the government, there was very strong rangeland management. There was wet season grazing and dry season grazing. There was very strong government regulation on charcoal production, something that has devastated the country, first in the north and now in the south. And, you know, after the government collapsed, that was holding all of this together, that was actually keeping the ecosystem healthy, that was making pastoralism actually viable way of, you know, living. You know, the rangeland management systems disappeared, the NGOs came and the UN came and everybody started drilling boreholes wherever they wanted. So there was no opportunity to force people to move away from the water, the management of the water systems is intricately linked to grazing. And that's not something the international community understands. And we were the first organization saying, stop drilling boreholes. You should have permanent water sources where it's needed, but you should be forcing people to move so that the land regenerates. That's what the government was doing. And that's just a very kind, what we thought as common sense, and come to find out was not well received by the international community. And I remember Fatima knocking on the doors of the donors, the EU and other donors, and telling them, we need to invest in natural resource management if you want to stop the cycle of poverty and droughts. The droughts are a link or a reflection or a manifestation of the poor situation of the ecology in Somalia. And we used to do a lot of research on some of this and as a way to do advocacy and all of that. And you know, the response from donors, Somalia is a fragile context. You're a humanitarian emergency context. We only give you humanitarian funding. We're not interested in long-term funding. So this is just, it's shocking to me that that donors didn't understand the direct links between humanitarian emergencies such as droughts and the poor condition of the environment and the ecosystem. And it's like they didn't want to understand. They just did not want to get it. And no matter how much we try to educate them. And so for me, I'm happy to see that there's interest now under the auspices of climate change. I'm not really sure if this is all as a result of climate change. Much of it is a lack of regulations and a lack of strong governance systems that are not in place to control the things the way that they used to be controlled by the former government. So yeah, I think there is a direct link between humanitarian crisis, particularly in fragile contexts, and the environment, but it's particularly in rural communities and communities that depend on livestock. But unfortunately, this is not a priority for the aid system when we rely on the international community and the aid sector to really support the communities and get away from, you know, the handouts and start thinking about what the root causes of these droughts and these famines and these humanitarian crises are.
Thank you so much. So much in there, you know, both in terms of, you know, the way in which the collapse of the state and the collapse of the government precipitated problems with environmental management, which ultimately have kind of degraded the ability of people to maintain their livelihoods, but also the impact of humanitarian interventions undermining the traditional ways of managing the rangeland and managing livelihoods as well. You mentioned the borehole drilling. And a big challenge there for the international community to understand the local context, understand what communities need, and to respond appropriately. I wonder, to your mind, what must humanitarian actors do to tackle the climate crisis in Somalia and other similar contexts?
They need to rely on local traditional knowledge. My mother is an avid environmentalist, not because it's something, it's a project that is funded by a donor, or it's a way to get funding from a donor, or because it's an issue area that I've now discovered is of concern to me. It's not that. It's because she deeply, deeply feels that, feels very, very connected to the land and the changes in the land. And it's something that is very painful for her to see what's happening, because she has memories of different days as a child. She has memories and she knows the plants as a pastoralist, because she was a pastoralist child. She knows which plants were used for what by her mother, which plants were used by other people for different things. She knows how they were using the land and the trees to make their homes, and all types of things. So unfortunately, that historical knowledge, that traditional knowledge, is not one thing that the international community first respects, values, and really understands the importance of it. So when we come to the international community and say, you're drilling boreholes in the wrong areas, drill boreholes. People need water. We're not saying don't give them water. We're not saying don't give livestock water. We're not saying make people die of thirst. But what we're saying is do it in an environmentally friendly way. Do semi-permanent water sources to force people to move so that they have water during the dry seasons, but they move. You know, this is all based on understanding of the land and the ecology. What I feel like the international community needs to do first and foremost is be humble and recognize they have no clue. They don't know what the hell they're doing. They really don't. And when we talk about localization or locally led humanitarian response, it's not rhetoric. It's based on real practical experience firsthand that we've seen. And unfortunately, you know, what I see is just more and more professionalization, more and more hubris, more and more arrogance, more and more, now climate change is the new opportunity to get funding. So everybody's fundraising and everybody's being climate experts and hiring climate specialists, you know, because they see the writing on the wall. It becomes another opportunity. It's not because the people are deeply moved and affected by it. And unfortunately, people of my mom's generation, they're all dying. And so that knowledge is getting lost. And the new generation, unfortunately, in Somalia really doesn't understand this as well. And they've just become very westernized and they just think that, we're just going to go into the urban centers and all of that. The knowledge is there, but we have to salvage it and we have to nourish it and we have to support it. And the current system doesn't exist to do that. The current system is not designed to do that.
Thank you so much, Degan. So really strong call there, clear call for like locally led approaches based on people's knowledge and understanding of the context and the situation. Let's move on to Abdurahman. You were director of Somalia's NGO Forum for quite some time and advised the government on aid and development issues. What do you see as being the major challenges that the government and local organizations have faced in tackling the climate crisis in Somalia?
Well, I think, you know, first of all, as Degan has said, one of the challenges you have is that, you know, that this issue of environment requires a longer term approach to address it. And the context in Somalia is unfortunately, you know, still predominantly seen as a humanitarian context. In the minds of donors, when they think about Somalia, I'm sure all they think about is food insecurity, it's security terrorism. So for the government, the challenge has been that because of the current circumstances, the number one priority has been, you know, security. And for local actors, however, they managed, you know, to fill in the gap because they've been the backbone of social infrastructure in the country, providing, you know, social services, which for them has been the number one priority. And I think, you know, that Adeso, as Degan has said rightly, has been one of the very few organizations from the very beginning who has been, you know, trying to highlight issues around climate change and how to better manage environment, but also renewable energy through the work of her mother. So because of the issue from the government side of prioritizing obviously the security aspects and the fact of having a budget that's extremely limited, it's impossible to really deal with the environment at the appropriate scale. But also there is no incentives from donors to really push on the addressing environmental issues, which are longer term issues that Somalia is affected by. You know, if you look at just the data since 2000, you know, you'll see that there's been at least, you know, 19 severe floods, 17 droughts, three times more the number of climate hazards that Somalia has experienced between 1970 and 1990. And recurrently over the years, you've been just looking at it from the humanitarian perspective, but not from the climate change and environmental, and why, you know, these instances have been actually accelerating more and more over the years. So I'd say these are some of the challenges. And I think, you know, that the local actors who are, who know the issue better than anyone are not part of these conversations. To address, you know, climate change, you obviously need, you know, local action, local communities to be able to participate in anticipating the disaster, informing and coordinating with governments and other international actors to create better coping mechanisms to address some of these challenges.
Thank you so much, Abdurahman. You've spoken clearly there about some of the challenges that come from the way that international actors understand the situation in Somalia, and the real importance of trying to address those environmental issues that Degan spoke about so clearly. I wonder, from the position of government or local NGOs, how do the conflict and, you know, governance challenges in Somalia affect their ability to address climate risks?
So one of the issue is, although there's not a direct correlation between environment and conflict, we know that there is a link. So it's not direct, but people affected by climate change may believe actually that they have less to lose by joining armed groups to survive when their livelihoods are affected. And that's where we see and we'll be able to observe, you know, the impact in these instances. So Degan mentioned rightly over, you know, grazing and water issues in the country. There are a lot of local conflicts, localized conflicts that are over water and grazing actually, because of the scarcity of water that is not available throughout the country. And so what you have is, in addition to just building boreholes anywhere, a lack of understanding of the peace building elements of the activities that you do, but also the impact that it can have on local conflicts. When you build a borehole that only obviously is accessible to one community versus the other. And when we were dealing with some of these issues at government, one of the common issues that would come is, you know, this other community that lives next to us has a borehole, but we don't. Can you build one for us? Or a hospital and we don't. Can you build one for us? So it's proved to be a challenge. And I think, you know, that there is a link, there is a strong link. That's also generating conflict out there, particularly in areas that are severely affected by climate dynamics. And there may be reasons why, for example, people feel that, you know, they're not being supported enough in addressing their issues and would go to the other side for support.
That's really interesting. I guess one of the things that we think about at IIED about in terms of trying to tackle climate change generally is that to tackle climate change, you really need to have an understanding of climate risks and like how the climate is going to change and how it might affect you, particularly for vulnerable communities or let's say areas that are particularly exposed to climate hazards. What are some of the challenges that, say, local governments or local NGOs have in actually, or communities in understanding those climate risks?
I think yes, obviously it's important. One of the challenges is the communication and how we communicate with communities to understand these challenges, but also. The issue is also that whilst, you know, a government can be centralized, it's very difficult to understand what's happening in specific contexts around the country. And that's where, you know, where the job I'm doing currently at Internews comes in, because we're supporting actually journalists to report on issues around climate change. And hold also power to account. So when there are issues around climate change that are not going right, or or whenever actors, whether it be government or international actors, are doing things that are not right, they need to be held accountable. Mm-hmm. And what we are seeing is that that's not happening to the scale that is wanted or that is needed. And I've seen that that on the discussion, there are a few journalists present. And one of the issue we have actually in the Global South is that climate change and environment is seen as an issue that comes from the North and doesn't affect the Global South, right? Mm. And so when journalists go to their editors, for example, and want to report on climate change, the editors will say, no, our priority are security issues or political issues. Climate change is something that happens in the North, doesn't affect us. Mm-hmm. And so there is this lack of understanding overall, which is impacting on the way we see things, I think, in places like Somalia. One of the examples is, for example, you know, we've been pushing for years to have a Ministry of Environment, and it still sits in the office of the Prime Minister. And it's been very, very difficult amongst, you know, the lots of other priorities to set aside climate as an important issue that needs to be tackled, where, you know, bills need to be issued in Parliament and some areas and need to be addressed. I think one of the major achievements that has been done in Somalia over the past years and because of a lot of advocacy, lobbying from different actors, local civil society, and international, has been the ban on charcoal and has reduced, I would say, dramatically the exportation of charcoal to other countries, although it's still happening on an illegal basis in that sense. So I think, you know, the information management of that is critical.
Thank you so much, Abdurahman. That's really fascinating. We're going to pull out the focus a little bit now from Somalia to think more broadly about this interrelationship between conflict, fragility, and climate change and humanitarian crisis. And move to Professor Kleena Raleigh. You've been examining patterns of violent conflict across fragile states for many years and have analyzed the complex interlinkages between governance, conflict, and environmental factors in many contexts. What does your research tell you about the role that climate change plays in shaping conflict, fragility, and humanitarian emergencies?
That's a great question. Thank you very much for having me. So I would say that it's very important to recognize that the primary and dominant and most widespread reaction to climate change is local cooperation. It's not conflict in any way, shape, or form. The conflict patterns that we're seeing, which are accelerating across many African states and many states around the world, do not appear to be driven by the environmental issues per se. And I think that's an important thing to just be very, very clear about. And the research doesn't support that either. What the research does support is very much along what Degan was saying, which is that if you don't have institutions in the first place to deal with issues that become crises to people, then you are likely to have more instability or deeper instability or longer lasting instability. And that is especially marked if you do not listen to what actual communities say about what they believe their risks are and how they want to solve them collectively. And I'm going to share my screen for just a second, because we've done some work about trying to be especially clear about this relationship. I hope you can see where the research at the moment does not support any sort of direct link between climate and conflict. Indeed, it even is very, very tenuous about the indirect links through migration or effects on income, et cetera. What we do know, of course, is that climate, more than anything else in the Global South, is affecting local community cooperation abilities and adaptation abilities. And if institutions are not supported by national and international efforts, then in fact, they might exacerbate some tensions already there, some political tensions that exist, or in fact, they might encourage cooperation and further aid. And so rather than asking what is the relationship between climate change and conflict, I think it's a much better in to ask what are the political consequences of dealing with climate change in any given country, because it's going to be markedly different for South Sudan than it is for Cameroon, than it is for Afghanistan. And so having a blanket policy is not particularly helpful because it's going to be shaped by the domestic political circumstances. And in particular, I think many people who look at the relationship between climate and conflict really miss that the way in which countries and localities are going to adapt to climate change is going to be through existing institutions. And whether or not those existing institutions are strong enough to deal with this additional crisis. And the existing institutions are things like natural resource management, land access ministries and quality debates, adaptation and mitigation policy debates, discussions about yields and productivity and how people are already trying to change those through typical development means, demographic and capacity debates, and disaster management institutions. And so climate change in and of itself doesn't arrive in a developing state and people have to deal with it. It's integrated into all of these different issues, which themselves have a particular type of political and conflict likelihood, especially as it's affecting different elites and power relationships. And that is distinct from assuming that environmental change creates violence, which is overly broad as a way to think about it. And I want to just say here that many times, I'm no climate expert, I really want to be clear about that at the moment, and emphasize that the conflicts that we're seeing in the global south, but also, of course, in the global north, are becoming far more widespread, they're becoming much more persistent, but unlike the conflicts of 20 years ago, they're now perpetrated by many more groups than they used to be. Gangs and militias, et cetera. And what that means is that a country like Mexico can, on different months, be as violent as Syria can be during its very, very kind of traditional civil war. And so, as Degan was mentioning, this placing countries into buckets of fragile and not fragile is missing how conflict has changed quite rapidly over the last decade or two. And in fact, people are dealing with multiple crises concurrently, but that doesn't mean they're related crises. So people have to deal with, of course, conflict risks. And of course, the most conflict that people experience is likely to be low fatality or no fatality and perpetrated by one of these gangs. And the threats to governments are really within governments increasingly rather than from outside. And that changes how policies about climate change and about climate change financing and about adaptation are going to influence the politics of those states and then how that might influence the conflict likelihood.
Fascinating insights there, Kalina. Really, really very clear as well about that testy question that we've been hearing about for 20 years about that relationship between climate change and conflict. And really, really good to hear kind of a building picture there from what Degan shared with us and what Abdurahman shared to what you're saying now about really the importance of the institutional structures and frameworks that underpin social cooperation rather than, and the way that intersects with climate change and the challenges that climate change presents. Really, really powerful. I'm wondering, in relation to what you were saying right at the end there, what kinds of challenges do these multiple and new forms of conflict and the different manifestations of, I don't want to say fragility now, but kind of, let's say, governance, pose for the efforts of governments and humanitarian actors in addressing this kind of existential challenge of climate change?
That's a really good question. And I think that the first thing that needs to be done is a reconceptualization of these conflict risks, as I was mentioning before. I think we have for many years presented conflict, especially domestic conflict, as a manifestation of grievance rather than what I think it's being driven by, which is elite competition. And so if we are to reframe conflict in that way, and trying to protect communities from it rather than trying to de-radicalize communities that aren't radicalized in the first place, then we really need to invest, I would say, far more in regional, sub-regional and local governance structures, because that's the front line of adaptation and mitigation of climate change. And I would say, again, that I really want to emphasize that when you invest in local governance, when you invest in local cooperation for climate change, it may in fact contribute a little to conflict risks? I mean, I don't know of any solution that both deals with climate risks and deals with conflict risks in a way that is going to mitigate both and not in some ways exacerbate the political dimensions that are underlying both of those things. Climate change adaptation and climate change policies are a political issue. Conflict is a competition for authority. And so those things together are not necessarily going to cooperate when it comes to solutions that are going to be viable. And so sometimes those local solutions, which are the most readily available for climate change, are going to be unfair. And they may in fact underlie some competition dynamics and authority debates, or debates is a nice word for it, but authority disputes that may have occurred anyway, but may not necessarily be brought to the fore as quickly as they would when there's new policies, new formal roles, and new money involved.
That's a really important point I think you're making there about this conflict being driven by elite competition and competitions over authority. And that really does pose us as climate people doing climate programming to think about the conflict sensitivity of what we do and to really understand the political economy that underpins everything that we're engaging with, whether we're doing humanitarian interventions or climate adaptation. Thanks so much, Cleena. I'm going to move over now to Paul. You've launched the Prepare initiative recently, which is aiming to help humanitarian agencies to respond more effectively to the global climate emergency, and particularly in these kinds of complex contexts. What challenges does climate change pose for humanitarian agencies that are operating in fragile and conflict-affected states from what you've been hearing?
Thanks, Simon, and hello, everyone. I'm concerned, I must say, that for a debate, I think we're going to have a massive sort of explosion of consensus around these issues, but let's see how we go. And I think I'll take a leaf out of Catherine Luna's book, who's been looking at the sort of incidence of conflict and climate change, if I may, to start with, and just say that, you know, by an accident of geography, the countries which are in the World Bank's fragile and conflict affected list are about twice as likely as average to be exposed to the risks of climate change. But those same countries, the conflict affected countries, are 4.5 times more likely than average to suffer from those effects. And the gap, of course, is coming from challenges around governance and challenges around response. So conflict-affected countries are peculiarly at risk and peculiarly have very specific difficulties in terms of addressing the climate risk. Not necessarily, and I thought that was fascinating what Cleena was saying, not necessarily because conflict causes climate, because climate causes conflict, but because the common denominator of climate change and of conflict is suffering, is human suffering. And what's happening is that climate is affecting people who are already at very, very heightened vulnerability as a result of the conflict, because of displacement, because of lack of access to traditional coping capacities. And where climate is affecting these states, the states also have less ability to, as we've heard, to respond, to adapt to climate change. So these things are forming this horrible, vicious puzzle of suffering. And that's I think, where they come together, and maybe what leads to what is less important than the fact that they all of these things enhance one another. So what that means for humanitarians, briefly, I think five things. Firstly, the formal, typical humanitarians working in conflict environments need to recognize that climate is an issue for them. A lot of the consultation, a lot of the interviews that we've done in Prepare, and I know that other agencies' concern has been working on this as well, talking to humanitarians working in conflict-affected environments, they see climate and conflict as somehow different things. And if we're doing conflict, if we're working in conflict, then climate is something else. And worryingly, sometimes they see them almost as kind of opposed things. You know, if you think about climate, you're not really worrying about the conflict. And so there is a mindset piece. I think that's the first one. The second is that I think we as humanitarians need to get over this magic bullet idea. There isn't a single programmatic approach which is going to address the suffering caused by conflict and climate together. We know responses are not good enough. They're not big enough. As you said earlier on, they're too stretched. That's not the answer. Anticipation is not the answer. It's not going to do it. DRR is not going to do it. And yet often these various approaches are pitched against each other. What we really need to be doing is coming up with layered strategies where all of these things support one another. In order to do it, and I think this is the third thing, humanitarians need to see ourselves as small supporting actors, spear carriers, if you like, in the larger picture and not the stars of the show. Humanitarians do not own these crises and are often extremely peripheral actually to the reality of how the crisis is working out. There is a contribution to be made, but the piece that Degan was saying about understanding where you are and how can your small contribution fit is probably the first step to effective programming in these situations. If nothing else, don't get in the way, don't make it worse. Possibly conversations around the nexus are one of the doorways to improving this. The fourth and by no means new point that I'd like to suggest for humanitarians is that finally we need to put frontline actors at the front of the line for funding. It's well evidenced now that in the majority of humanitarian situations, it is civil society organizations on the front line who are doing most of the work anyway. And with the climate situation getting worse and worse and locked in, whatever we do, that is locked in. With the massive increase in need that is forecast, with the lack of access that's forecast, potentially with declining funding going to internationals, internationals need to be working out how they can very rapidly be putting their efforts into the support of civil society and frontline response. And then finally, this is particularly challenging, I think, in a conflict environment, because unfortunately, civil society response is not enough. You know, all of the evaluations of humanitarian action around climate and around resilience, almost all of them suggest you can't be effective unless you're working with civil society or civil society is working under the overall planning and management of the state. So the question is, what do you do where the state is less able to do that or potentially not present? And I think that's a thing that we haven't worked out, and we all need to be thinking about how to work that out quite soon. But part of that needs to be perhaps being a little bit more thoughtful about which elements of government are working. You know, are there social welfare parts of the government that are working? Is local government working, even if central government isn't? And how can they be supported or to articulate with civil society? And second of all, if there's really nothing there, what is the role of external humanitarians in helping civil society scale up to a point where it's actually at a broad scale, which is a huge challenge, but one that maybe our other speakers have answers to. So those would be five pointers. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Paul. A really clear set of opportunities, let's say, rather than challenges, opportunities for the humanitarian sector to respond to. So happily, we have two excellent representatives from the humanitarian sector to kind of come in now. Katrine Loon and Caroline Voot, you're both working with major humanitarian agencies to try and change the way that you address the risks posed by climate change for the most vulnerable people in complex and conflict-affected contexts. I put this question to both of you. How does climate change complicate the work of your agencies or other agencies in responding to humanitarian needs, whether they're caused by conflict or caused by other causes, with maybe climate-related disasters? Maybe Katrine, could you?
Sure, thank you. And thank you very much for the invitation. Now, it's becoming a bit of a hard task in the sense that we've heard a lot already, so I'll probably be reinforcing a number of points made by others in answering your first question or giving talk to your first question. So how is climate change complicating our work in situations of conflict? Just to take one or two steps back, I think the way we've been trying to envision the impacts or the humanitarian consequences of converging climate risks and armed conflict is to nearly imagine layers of vulnerability that end up compounding one another and ultimately affect all dimensions of people's lives, from their safety to their health, to their food, water, economic security. And this means that when we're thinking responses, we need to be capturing those elements that are coming together, amplifying some impacts. And in some cases, you have a situation that is relatively stable and is suddenly further destabilized by a disaster, for instance, by a shock. And I think, what I've heard from others now is the recognition that conflicts will harm development, social cohesion, essential services, institutions, their ability to manage resources. And this leads to an increase in needs. Then climate change will further exacerbate a number of these elements, exacerbating food insecurity, creating fertile grounds for certain diseases. You might have disasters destroying infrastructure or supply chains. So we're basically in a situation where needs seem to be constantly exacerbated and people's vulnerabilities seem to be constantly exacerbated. And we could also represent the pandemics as another layer of vulnerability that is interacting with these layers. Now, in looking at what this means for us, I think we need to recognize that all situations are different, as we know. So for instance, if we look at situations where you might have an ongoing conflict and a disaster strikes, and northern Mozambique with Cyclone Kenneth was a very good example of that, you end up in a place where you have needs related to the disaster, and it's extremely hard to respond to these needs because your humanitarian access is extremely limited by the situation of conflict. Then you have situations in northern Mali, I think, that we covered in the research that we did in When Rain Turns to Dust, is a good illustration of a place where people have long coped with climate risks. And then you have a conflict that will hinder their usual ways of coping. That's a place where people, in the face of a bad season, would normally travel longer distances with their cattle to find grazing land and water. This becomes impossible when you have a conflict that's preventing people from moving safely with their animals. And there again, the conflict will limit the capacity of the state, the capacity of humanitarian actors to assist. Then if we're looking at situations that, if we're looking at disasters in particular, these can also limit our own capacity to operate beyond the challenges to humanitarian access that might be created by insecurity. You also have situations where roads are being destroyed, infrastructure is being destroyed. And we've had cases where heat turned into a significant problem. So we had to stop using planes in southern Iraq a few years ago because the heat was such that it was dangerous for tires to explode. So you have those situations where operating can
can be quite challenged by disasters themselves. And then you have a greater complexity of needs that must be taken into account. I think the one thing I'd underscore there, and Paul was alluding to that, is the challenge we have as humanitarian actors in somehow working on different temporalities. We need to be addressing urgent needs. That's how we're designed. And so we will respond to a shock providing emergency assistance. Now, when we're looking at climate risks, of course, we're looking at immediate impacts, but we're also significantly looking at much longer term impacts. And when Degan was talking of providing access to water to communities, it's an extremely good example of that. You need to be building into the design of your program not only the fact that you want to be providing water to communities immediately, but you also need to be looking into what are the projections in terms of how water tables will be evolving in the future if I want to be providing water in a sustainable manner. And although I think in theory, we all agree to this, we all agree to the fact that it's about tackling emergency needs as well as building resilience to longer term risks, I don't think we're that good at doing that for the time being. So there's still that element of let's first respond to the emergency and then let's look at the longer term needs. But the reality of crisis is that you often have a repetition of shocks. So you might not have a lull where you say, okay, now we will be tackling longer term needs. I'll stop here. That was a bit of a convoluted answer to your question, but I hope that helps.
Oh, it was really fascinating, and you covered a lot of ground quite quickly. Let's go over to Caroline. And how is MSF addressing these complications, these complexities that Katrina has mentioned? I'm thinking particularly from an operational perspective, and that last issue that Katrina raised about how you deal with those different temporalities by responding, but also supporting the development of those institutional or other kinds of capabilities over the long term that we need to address climate change. How are you tackling those issues?
Yeah, I mean, a lot has already been covered here by all the wonderful panelists, but thanks for asking. I'll share a little bit about then the MSF experience, which as a medical humanitarian organization, you know, we've found over time, obviously we work in multiple countries where we're already actually responding to situations that are likely linked to the changing environment. So it's perhaps not about fundamentally reinventing operations, but recognizing this fact and expanding perspectives to tailor actions a little bit more specifically around climate and environmental impacts. So adding an additional lens to the way that we work, so to speak. The problem for humanitarians and for healthcare practitioners alike is that we tend to intervene at the end of the equation. So the outcome of the crisis is already in front of us. The impacts are hard to see until they're already in front of you. So it's often difficult to sort through the confounding factors and really make the link with the attribution science to say what we're responding to here right now is actually linked to XYZ related to the climate crisis. However, it has, and particularly for a fiercely independent organization like MSF, it has really reminded us of the importance of partnership with people and organizations and centers of expertise that can provide this science, and specifically at national and local levels. Everybody's spoken a little bit about this already, but one of the most complex factors that we see these days is obviously that emergencies that we face are becoming more severe and erratic over time. This includes infectious diseases such as malaria, dengue, and cholera, which result from changing rainfall and temperature patterns. It includes zoonotic diseases that change due to increased pressure on the environment. Extreme weather events we've spoken a little bit about, you know, cyclones and hurricanes, and then malnutrition and links with drought. So these erratic cycles and these continued events, they really take a toll on people, and no one gets time to recover in between, as Catherine said earlier. So it's no time between one crisis and the next, and we know that this is going to continue and get worse. What we've seen the same impacts also in terms of healthcare settings. Health systems are squeezed by connected and compounding health crises. In many countries, we saw already health systems are under considerable strain. We saw how everyone tried to manage COVID, but you can imagine adding, you know, general healthcare management for the environment where you're working, for the geography that you're supposed to cover, but add a flooded health center or hospital to that, or add an additional outbreak of a climate-sensitive disease that is larger than predicted or new to your environment, or add that you were supposed to cover, you know, X thousands of people in your geographic region, but people have been displaced suddenly and you must manage also the health needs of a displaced population. So there are many different kind of complicating factors. In terms of how MSF has tried to approach this, we're looking at it from three different levels. So we've kind of got a three tiered response, operations, analysis and research, and our footprint. In our perspective, because we operate under the principle of do no harm, this requires the organization to lead at medical activities today that are in such a way that we protect the health and lives of people tomorrow. And I say that it's a process. We're very imperfect at it at the moment, but we've committed to really rise to this challenge to the best of our ability. Humanitarian action, as it's designed at the moment, is very carbon intensive. And the nature of MSF's work responding to crises around the world remains quite carbon intensive. So addressing our environmental footprint is priority, but presents a lot of challenges. But it's important. It's an important first step, measuring, mitigating, going forwards from that direction. How MSF is also looking at our operational strategies, like I said, tailoring, looking at as the needs change, you know, so will our medical action, tailoring our operations to better respond to realities that we did not keep in our mind's eye before. And we're looking at adjusting research agendas specifically because, you know, there are big gaps in knowledge and neglected areas within the global health and humanitarian system for vulnerable people that are affected by climate change and environmental degradation. And there is quite a lot to contribute there that will very strongly influence broader policy advocacy or legal initiatives. So we do see an added value in ensuring our work contributes to furthering that knowledge gap or filling that knowledge gap.
Thank you so much, Caroline. Really interesting to hear those practical ways in which you're trying to address that. We've heard a number of different things today, from the real need to localize humanitarian action or action across the board in these kinds of contexts, to challenges with donor funding, donor priorities, and the humanitarian financing gap, for instance. We've heard about particular kinds of different perspectives from those who are funding or supporting action in these kinds of contexts. So issues at the local level, from the local to the international level, which pose a real challenge to the humanitarian system as a whole. I wonder how Katrine, ICRC or MSF is thinking about how climate change poses a challenge to that humanitarian system. Do you have what it takes to respond to this challenge in the ways that you need to, particularly in these contexts where maybe there aren't many development actors, where states are, as Paul put it, not don't have the reach or the capability to do what might be needed in a more stable context? How do you see that as humanitarian organizations, and what might we think about as a community in terms of addressing structural problems within the sector?
I think to start, we see that as a huge challenge. I'd like to say we own all the answers and know how to do this, but I don't think that would be right. I think, as Paul alluded to, and we've heard from Abdurahman and Degan as well, the humanitarian response is a small part of the equation. We need to get it right. Now, I think one of the challenges we have is that in a number of places where we'd like to say a big development actor will make sure that there's a sustainable access to water for the whole community, this might not be happening because we do know that development efforts are often quite significantly hampered by insecurity. So we are very much in a place, as an organization, we have committed to factoring climate and environmental risks across programs. I think that's one small step. We've also been working quite strongly with the humanitarian sector to try to guide responses, steer responses when it comes to climate action. And this is the work we've done through the development of the Climate and Environment Charter for humanitarian organizations. Now, the charter itself does flag the need to mobilize other actors because we're completely aware that this is a large part of the equation. But to be able to do this, we need to convince everyone that there has to be an acceptance of a certain level of risks. There has to be an acceptance of the fact that you might be working with different partners. And this connects us very much to the discussion on local action, because it's clear that a large part of this action needs to be driven by communities, so by very local actors. And so all of this requires quite a bit of mobilization, I think, to get the right responses. I think at the theoretical level, there's an agreement that we need development, humanitarian, and peace actors to work together. In practice, we're quite far from there. So to us, there's really been that effort to both get our operations right, but also recognizing that this will really not be sufficient. So we need to do our part. We need to mobilize others so they strengthen their part. And the other element that I think is important in the Climate and Environment Charter, and this is very much why we've worked on this to bring the sector together, is the recognition that we should be helping one another. So we should be supporting the efforts of various actors to integrate those risks into their ways of operating, knowing that we don't have all the same capacity to be developing tools or to be engaging with researchers. So there's very much that idea of a collective endeavor if we want to get the response right. And to some extent, this connects to what Caroline was saying about the fact that MSF might not be an organization that partners so easily with others. That is applicable to the ICRC as well, I think. And so to us, the move to develop that type of engagement and work is very much that realization of, no, we need to be partnering with others. And that's a case where we need to be learning a lot from others, because we can't pretend that we have that knowledge in the ICRC that has been developed for an extended period of time. So it's a bit of a shift in terms of how we approach the question and how we envision our relationship with the rest of the sector, but I mean also far beyond the sector, all other relevant actors in that case. Thanks
so much, Catherine. I it's really great to hear you really focusing there on the need for partnership and collaboration, going beyond just coordination, which tends to be the preoccupation of the humanitarian sector. And this is something you mentioned too, Caroline, is the need for partnership. How is MSF trying to achieve those different and improved kinds of partnerships to deal with these issues?
Good question. And again, it's hard to add more to what's been said already very eloquently. But I would say there's kind of two levels of partnerships that we're talking about. Is really kind of going back to one of the five recommendations from Paul, this, you know, putting frontline, you know, people on the front line, which is being led in our priorities and where the action is really needed by people who are living through changes. Now, in terms of the way that emergency operations work, it's not usually, we're not well renowned for being the most, you know, taking enough time to really engage with individuals and communities about the issues. We tend to arrive, assess the issue, and set up an emergency operation really quickly. But we're working on changing that process to something a bit more organic, much more guided by affected populations. Because, you know, when we speak to people in Chad or in Honduras or in Madagascar, you know, they're not using terms such as, you know, the COP academics are, to describe their realities, and or sometimes they don't even recognize that the driving force behind the issue that they're facing may be some kind of environmental change, but they can speak to changes that they're experiencing over time. They can speak to the coping strategies that they've had to adopt. which force them to change their lives, their livelihoods, and even their family structures. So partnership at that level to be led in the right direction. And then partnerships with, you know, not just academic institutions, but with green technologies. We've got a lot of work to do in looking at our supply chain, how to move towards more responsible programming, work to do. You know, we've encountered quite a few medical operations where there was a limited amount we could do at the end, aside from keep people healthy. But if you look at, for instance, exposure to, you know, lead poisoning in mining situations, you know, that's an exposure that's going to continue unless there is a policy and legal intervention that comes afterwards. So in that respect, there needs to be some sort of continuity that MSF is not adapted to present. And so it leads back to partnerships. It's kind of a continuum of care, but not just in a healthcare way.
Great, thank you. I'd like to return to Degan Ali and kind of bring this back to the realities on the ground in a country like Somalia. Degan, what is your thinking about what you've heard today from the other participants, and kind of what do you think needs to happen to change things in terms of building institutions, delivering really locally led action to address climate and conflict risks in Somalia?
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of it has already been covered, and it's hard to follow all of those great presenters. I think one of the biggest problems in the sector as a whole is that we oftentimes think that the humanitarian development actors are the duty bearers, but they're not. It's the government. And unfortunately, you know, when we have fragile contexts where we have weak governments like Somalia, I haven't seen anyways in my 20 plus years of working in Somalia, any systemic and deep investments in the capacity of the various ministries, the relevant ministries, and the linkage between the ministries and the federal states at the local level. Those mechanisms are extremely weak. And, you know, if we spent even 5-10% of what we spend on aid in just serious capacity development in the past 10-15 years, I think we would have had a very strong institutions. But unfortunately, what we do in the sector is we undermine government capacity, we undermine government sovereignty, we undermine in an effort to ensure that we stay relevant and we're funded. And I include the UN in this, not just the INGOs in the UN, but even the local NGOs who benefit financially from this system. So I would say, first and foremost, we need to really double our efforts and supporting government capacity, because it's their responsibility to create the mechanisms, the infrastructure that supports the regulations and implement and enforce those regulations. We have charcoal regulations in Puntland and Somaliland, but they're not enforced. Why? Because we don't have any mechanism of monitoring on the ground. We don't have rangeland rangers that we used to have, that the former government used to pay their salaries for. We don't, you know, we can have community accountability mechanisms. The communities can enforce some of this, but they need incentives. They need support. They need fuel. They need vehicles. They need all of these things. So, I mean, I think that's where we need to be resourcing as much as possible, not the government overall policy at the global level, at the national level only, but also at the very local level as well, making sure that these policies cascade to the local communities and they're implemented properly.
Thank you so much, Degan. I wonder if Abdurahman, you've got some thoughts on that from, you know, having sat within the Prime Minister's office at a time when there was a great expansion of finance for, let's say, state building, for want of a better word. And given the amount of effort and money that has gone into building state institutions in one way or another.
Yeah, I think I have 2 points to add. One is I saw a comment just about the what I made. I said earlier about having a Ministry of Environment is important. And someone mentioned, shouldn't it be better to have a department within the Ministry of Finance And what you'll see is that when I was in the system, I was one of those who opposed actually having different projects within the Ministry of Finance, because you needed a whole department or new ministry to deal with such issues. And with in a context that's fragile like Somalia, where institutions are fragile, a Ministry of Finance can easily divert from its core functions and then become a Ministry of Environment if you add in an environmental component to it. So I would warn against that. But the Ministry of Finance can play an important coordinating role when it's, you know, coordinating, for example, funding from international financing institutions and coordinating with international partners how best and effective to use those funds in Somalia. The other point is, I saw another point on OCHA saying what can be better done. And one thing that came in my mind in the past few days is, you know, we have so many sophisticated clusters in the humanitarian system, but there's no cluster that is specifically focused on climate change, environmental issues. And perhaps, you know, it's worth looking at that at a cluster or mechanism in which, whilst we're doing humanitarian operations, we make sure that, you know, we're not doing more harm to the environment than we're supposed to do. And I think, you know, that's critically important. But the key aspect in all of this is that to deal with the environment, we have to have and consult with environmental experts, right? And the environmental experts cannot only come at 75% from the north of this part of the world. And that's where the localization comes in. You know, back in the days, and when you used to hear in previous government before the war, there used to be a lot of expertise. People sent for PhDs and studies abroad to actually understand, you know, the environmental impact and how to address that and challenge that on the ground. And we need to build that expertise in country so that, you know, we can build better policies to address those. But I think that it's important also that as we build the capacity of the government, we also recognize the role that the government has to play in addressing climate change issues. And in my experience in Somalia, that has not been always the case. And you've had cases where international partners try to put down or demean the government when it's trying to tackle serious issues. And we prefer to deal with the status quo, if I say what I mean. For example, if you look at, you know, a city like Mogadishu, which is 2 million inhabited by 2 million people, it's constantly growing. And yet, you know, we keep on building roads without considering sewage systems. We keep on expanding the city without, you know, considering how the waste is going to manage. And people in the city itself are building, you know, boreholes and water wells to be supplied on water. And even those wells are actually contaminated because they're very close to the sea. You know, it's if you go to Mogadishu, most of the time you'll have a shower with salted water. And so those issues at the core, and even in a very populated city like Mogadishu, are not being addressed. I give you an example. I was in the office of the Prime Minister. One issue we had is that actually the UN was incinerating rubbish inside the airport. And we told them, stop doing that. And instead, help us manage waste 20 kilometers outside of Mogadishu. And the answer was, no, it's too risky. It's too much security issues. We can't take the waste out of Mogadishu. In the heart of Mogadishu, incinerating, you know, waste just next to the airstrip. And we couldn't do it. We couldn't stop them doing that. And I think, you know, that's one of the core challenges of being in a fragile context.
Thank you so much, Abdurahman. Kleena, do you have any thoughts on, particularly on these kind of questions around building institutions that might support the kinds of cooperation that you were talking about earlier on?
I wish I had more thoughts on those things, in part just because I'm a real conflict ground person. But but I will say that, I mean, I don't mean to make everything seem worse, but we are working towards a time where there's going to be and has been kind of a reversion towards an autocratic mean rather than democratic practices, which means that many of these institutions are likely going to continue to be politicized and transactional in how they work on the ground. And so I think we have to obviously work within the context that we're given. I suppose one of my main issues was that this was a discussion that's picking up a lot of speed, the potential relationship between climate and conflict. It's picking up a lot of speed, and it is securitizing the wrong things about this relationship. And of course, we can really easily, I'd say, put together some sort of this is what modern conflict looks like, and this is what climate change in different places look like, and what is the likelihood that they're going to work together. And from that, come up with policies that will be enacted subnationally to make for the best outcome. But I suppose one of the challenges I see in this, which I can't quite get around, is that it will need to be adapted to almost every community and every circumstance. So there's no homogenous policy that you simply enact. And I think, you know, quite a lot of what a national government does that we miss in the global north sometimes is a lot of it is just management of subnational entities that either can't or won't, or for whatever reason, aren't doing what the national level wants them to do. And adding in a crisis to that, whether it's a conflict crisis or a climate crisis or a humanitarian crisis of any kind, exacerbates the lack of alignment and the lack of coordination. And that often has some violent ends, but it does prolong these crises that might seem outside of this, well, it's just a matter of managing, you know, 200 plus communities. But I would say it's a very tricky and difficult, well, there's no end point, I guess. It's just a tricky process to start.
Mm. Thank you, Cleena.
Should I come in with some questions from the floor?
Yes, please do, Nora. Thank you.
Great. So I just have one question right now. Across discussions like this, there seems to be a lot of consensus on the need for rethinking funding mechanisms and connecting humanitarian emergency interventions with development / long-term programming. This includes organizations all along the funding supply chain. So if everyone seems to agree, where is the holdup? What are the institutional or very practical barriers to making this happen?
A great question. I wonder, Paul or Katrine or Caroline, yeah, from where you sit, how do you see that question? What's getting in the way of the humanitarian system?
I'm happy to jump in, but also happy to let others start.
Go ahead, Katrine, and then I think Paul has something to.
Great. So a few points here. I think, so there's funding to humanitarian action. Now, what we're discussing here is how do we support climate action, I think, be it implemented by humanitarian actors or other actors. And there, I think the part of the funding we need to be looking into is not only humanitarian funding, but also climate funding and development funding. What's coming in the way, I think, when it comes to climate and development funding, access requirements for fragile countries are extremely difficult to meet. So we end up with real gaps that mean that despite clear commitments to help countries adapt to a changing climate, money is not flowing in the right direction. And when it's getting to these countries, it tends not to get to the localities that are the most unstable, and in particular when these are not under the control of the government. So there, I think we really need to rethink that dimension, because I think we made clear in this discussion that, I mean, ultimately, yes, humanitarian actors have a role to play, but we need to think beyond humanitarian action. And so I think we need to frame that question more broadly about how do we make sure that the right type of support is provided to local actors. And this connects very much with the idea of we need to be diversifying actors, because it's not always your central government that will be in a position to support climate action in a given location. And for now, we're very much looking at a system where money goes to central authorities and may not then be disbursed at a much more local level where action is needed. And whereas with development money, we will not have a humanitarian window. I think with climate money, there's an element there of making the case for money that needs to be allocated to more humanitarian in nature type of activities. So I think the question of burdensome access requirement is coming in the way. Then I think when we're looking at highly unstable location and money that is not identified as humanitarian money, you have the whole question of sanctions and how is money not allocated to certain territories because of the terrorist list, for instance. So there, I think we really need to think of those modalities of access as well, because what's needed is not only emergency assistance. And very quickly in a number of locations, you run into the tension between what's needed and what type of funding could you be tapping into.
Really, really helpful and not challenges that we actually see across, say, the least developed countries group, not just limited to those that are really at the bottom of the fragile conflict context list. Paul.
I was actually, the sign I was making was that I was very happy for Kathleen Luna to take that question. But now that she has, and given most of the answer, I would just add maybe a couple of thoughts. With respect to the, as Kathleen Luna was saying, I think there are sort of three large areas of funding: humanitarian funding, development funding, and climate funding. And these are complicated because they're also going in different modalities. Some are grants, some are loans, and there's all sorts of different levels of it. I certainly find it very hard to get my head around, but I'm no specialist. The humanitarian development piece, I think a lot of evaluations of this problem, the fact that people say they want the money to come together, and yet it doesn't, focus on a couple of areas. The first is around the work processes, diagnostic and planning processes on the ground, because there's a lot of, anyone who's on the ground knows there's an awful lot of diagnosis and planning going on, and often the development and the humanitarian ones are being done separately and differently. And then there's an attempt to kind of retrofit them. So some of it is as simple as that, is just how the work is planned. Further back the stream, as the questioner is suggesting, it's all the way up the stream. Another real constraint is actually within the organizations, both operational organizations and donor organizations have tended to make a very clear line between humanitarian and development, which is reflected in their, this is not true for all, but reflected in the funding sources. You'll have different funding streams, which require different reporting, and which are often being run out of different offices in the same organization. And because so much climate work, as we were saying earlier on, is about what are the relationships between response, DRR, anticipation, and so on, a lot of the work falls into the gaps between those different streams and those different offices. So those are the practical problems. And I think they're quite well known, actually, by people who've been trying to get some work done. And I know that some of the donors, Switzerland, for example, are restructuring to try and make this easier to do. Then there is as well, as Catherine Luna was saying, that the climate funding, which is possibly in danger of taking on the very worst of humanitarian funding, in as much as not going to civil society organizations, as you were saying, being almost impossible to access. But also some other bad sort of elements, which are that it doesn't seem to go to fragile states, conflict affected states, because those states are less able to produce shovel ready big programs which the donors want to fund. And so the sort of things that these states are able to put forward, the cost actually of putting the proposals forward is too high for them to access. One final thought is the other piece about climate is how, which affects particularly many of these states, is that the loss and damage element, that is the funding for all of the people who have fallen through the net of mitigation and adaptation, is very much the poor relation in the climate talks, and very much around this COP is a poor relation. That might not be the case next year. But Simon, I know you've actually been working on this for quite some time. So maybe IIED's got thoughts about loss and damage.
Indeed, this is something we're thinking about really actively. And I think, Catherine Loon, this is something that you're kind of moving towards in the comments that you're making, is that there is this gap between what is allocated through climate finance mechanisms that's available for mitigation and adaptation, what's available through the humanitarian funding channels, and a need to bridge that gap. That's certainly very much kind of how I'm thinking about what loss and damage financing might mean in practice, is how we can maybe either create new modalities or use existing modalities to get more finance into the kinds of action that we need to address loss and damage in these kinds of contexts, taking into account all of the challenges that come with the existing financial architecture in terms of access to finance. Places like Somalia, South Sudan, many of the Sahelian countries simply don't have the climate records available to put together an application to the Green Climate Fund. That's the only fund under the UNFCCC that actually has maybe the opportunity of getting some loss and damage finance or some adaptation finance. So that's effectively blocked for them, let alone the local organizations like Degan's that might be wanting to access climate finance, or the, you know, we're looking at the potential for things like frontline funds to get money to the grassroots for climate action. Incredibly difficult in these kinds of contexts. I want to end with reference to one of the questions or comments that came through from Duncan Pruitt at Oxfam that brings us back to some of the things that you were saying, Cleena, which is, what is the potential for the new surge of climate finance to actually exacerbate existing conflict among elites who are competing for scarce resources within these contexts? There's a huge amount of interest in climate finance as being an elixir for many of these challenges, but maybe it will just add fuel to the fire. So I want to wrap up. We're very close to the end. I really want to thank everybody who's participated on the panel. Thank you so much for your insights, for your different perspectives, to Degan Ali and to Abdurahman Sharif for your really rich insights from Somalia, and really driving home the importance, not just of localization and locally led climate action, but of building the institutions at the local and national levels to deliver these longer term impacts. To Paul, for your thoughts on the nature and the system of the humanitarian systems, five really great recommendations there for humanitarians. Cleena, for really grounding us in understanding better that relationship between climate change, governance, and conflict, and to focus our attention on some of those political economic drivers of conflict, more and the importance of institutions. And then to Catherine and Caroline, thanks so much. Really amazing to hear what you're doing in the ICRC and the MSF, and to hear about what we might do more broadly within the humanitarian community to address this climate emergency. So thanks, everybody. Not enough time to get into all of this in a great deal of detail, but a really wonderful start to thinking about this more practically. And thanks also to our audience, everybody who submitted comments and questions. Sorry that we couldn't get to everybody, but we will take those. This will be put online, so you'll be able to refer back and listen to the debate again if you so wish. So thank you, everybody. Signing off now, and thanks for a great debate.